Good morning. Am I loud? That's okay. Is it possible to give me less spotlight, please? I prefer that. Nobody needs to see me. Everything's going on the screen. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the wonderful world of ships and the beginning of art moderne on the oceans. In 1925, the French art establishment decided it was time the world took a leap into the future. The world had just got over mass slaughter of the First World War, and we were all tired of horror and ugliness and grayness. So a great exhibition of interiors and industrial design was held in Paris in 1925. It became known as the decorative exhibition Art Moderne. Today we know that period as Art Deco, but the phrase was not used until well into the 1950s. Up to then, it was just known as Art Moderne. Great ocean liners, up to the mid-20s, all had interiors that resembled great interiors of buildings. Historical, Georgian, Carolean, French Louis, Tudor, all sorts of things were inside ships. And they tried to emulate that which people recognized as being luxurious and being familiar on land. The great holds, the hotels, the country houses and the castles and the palaces, all reproduced in miniature within the hull of a ship. But the French decided otherwise. They decided that it was time to have new looks on the Atlantic. In the mid-1920s, the world started to suffer from what was in America the Great Depression, and business was falling off on the Atlantic. So all the shipping companies were thinking of what can they do to bring people in. We'll bring something new, we'll bring something bigger perhaps, we'll bring something faster perhaps. And the French decided, we are going to bring in modern. We're going to change the whole look of what interior design would be. So they decided to build, first of all, the largest ship they had ever owned. They never owned very large ships, about 25 to 30,000 tons. And they decided it was time to build their largest ship to compete with the rest of the world. So they would build a ship that would be of 45,000 tons. The general idea was they were going to build an Art Moderne ocean liner. But she would be an experiment. They had something greater in mind. And they thought if this great ship was successful, especially for Americans, because all transatlantic liners were basically based and shown to be for Americans. They were the whole reason for being for great transatlantic liners, especially after the years of mass immigration had waned. So they decided they would build a ship and they would call her the Ile de France. The Ile de France was a wow. The Americans absolutely loved her. 43,153 gross tons, launched in Saint-Nazaire in France in 1926. She went on her maiden voyage in 1927, 791 feet long, revolutionary in her interiors. She was a ship that did carry three classes of passengers, but she's only remembered for her first class. Almost 1,800 passengers would be carried. she would epitomize the Roaring Twenties. And at some point, she became known as early Ginger Rogers. The first streamlined, first Art Deco. And she brought in a style which eventually became known as the ocean liner style. Every ship that came after Ile de France had something of this French innovation. Every ship, even up to today. But Ile de France was only going to be an experiment. Something different, something bigger, something better, something more amazing was in the minds of the directors of the Compagnie Générale Transatlantique. On the outside, the ship didn't look all that different. She had three funnels, she was rather square. 43,000 tons was an intermediate liner. They had ships at that point of well over 50,000 tons. Cunard had large ships. The Germans had large ships. And even the Italians had 50,000 tonners, all vying for attention and all vying to get the award as a blue ribbon as the fastest ships in the world. Ile de France was never designed to be an extremely fast ship. She was designed to be unique. The interiors were really remarkable. It was a wow, as they say. All the top French designers, artists, were employed by the French line to create rooms for Ile de France. Up to that point, most great ships and shipyards used in-house designers to design the interiors of their ships. They didn't have the great designers of the nation, the great artists of the nation. The French were the first to think of this, and it was to be an advertisement for France. This is her entrance hall. We're talking about 1927, it's almost 100 years ago. This is historic. And anything I'm showing you today will look familiar. It won't look old-fashioned. Stick any of this in any modern ship or even any new hotel, because the hotels around the world started to take note of what was going on in the Atlantic. And the great new buildings that were being built in New York and Paris, London and Berlin suddenly became Art Nouveau, Art Deco and Art Moderne interior buildings. Such as the Dorchester, the Shawshank, all these great hotels suddenly blossomed as being modern and looked like the interior of ships. So what do we have here, which is so different? Well, obviously, the first thing you notice is the mirror. Nobody had used mirrors before to actually make the whole interior of the ship look bigger. Three decks in height. The entrance hall, you entered the ship here, staircases going up. The walls were all covered in slivers of Pyrenean marble. It had to be slivers, otherwise it would have been too heavy. But it was green and gray marble. Lights, you walked in here and the whole thing was absolutely ablaze with light. But where's it coming from? You couldn't see the light source. It was hidden in cornices around the ceiling. The ceilings were gilded. The columns had huge urns on the top with lights that shot up to the ceilings. The metalwork was all new. It was silvered bronze. So immediately you came on, you had this atrium that was quite unusual. At the top deck of that atrium, you had the tea room. The tea room itself was ultra modern. Look at the statues. Look at the furniture. Everything I'm going to show you, try and look at the details. In the details, you see the difference of what had just arrived. open space, high ceilings. Metallurgy had advanced to such a degree that it was able to have huge steel girders hidden above to support these large rooms. You didn't have to have a lot of columns. Three decks in height, very high windows. The furniture was light and airy. The rugs were beautiful. The carpets were polished. The paintings were all new. And you had a tremendous amount of embroidery on the furniture. The first class restaurant. We're talking of a ship of 36,000 tons, about half the size of Aurora. But you had all first class passengers dining at one sitting. And it looked like a Greek temple. The room was also lined with Pyrenean marble. In stages, three decks in height, huge mural paintings, and all the seats and chairs in this room were ultra-modern, and they were all silver leaf. Very beautiful. Ile de France was an instant success. The Americans absolutely loved it. They flocked to her. She was filled in every voyage from New York to France and to England. But it gave the French the go-ahead. What was the go-ahead? 1927, 1928, heading for the 30s. The great British company Cunard had announced that they were going to build a vast new superliner, a ship of over 80,000 tons and a ship of over 1,000 feet in length. She would be the longest and the largest ship ever created. She would be a modern ship. The great White Star Line, at about the same time in the mid-1920s, decided they too were going to build the very first ship of over 1,000 feet in length. She would be built in Belfast, as all White Star ships would be. They gave her a name already. She was going to be called the Oceanic. She was going to be a three-funnel motor ship, and 1,000 feet in length and about 76,000 tons. But they decided, after they'd even laid the keel, that this wasn't the time to build such a ship. Business was bad, they were running out of money, so they cancelled the idea. But Cunard carried on with the idea of building a great ship in Scotland. And at the same time, the French line decided, here was the chance to build the ship of France, the ship of ships, the ship like no other. And as it turned out, this great ocean liner became the most perfect, most wonderful ocean liner the world had ever seen and has ever seen. Ile de France plied the route, made money, went into the Second World War. Germany conquered France, and Ile de France was taken over by the British Merchant Navy, and she was handled as a troop ship by P&O all through the Second World War. At the end of the war, she went back to France. She was modernized, two funnels instead of three, and she ended up, sadly, at the breakers in Osaka, in Japan, and there they took her and they virtually annihilated the whole idea of the ship by putting it in a movie. The shipbreakers rented the ship out, and during the course of this horrible last voyage movie, they decimated the Ile de France, and the French were horrified because they'd already given the ship the Croix de Guerre for bravery during the war, and it caused an incident between France and Japan, and the Japanese apologized, and the ship then had a Shinto ceremony. Her soul was cleansed, order was maintained, and Ile de France finally went to her happy hunting ground. That left another idea in the head. What are we going to show the world? She was called Normandie. And any ship buff who speaks of Normandie speaks in rather hushed tones. Perfect, exquisite, over the top. The money spent to build this ship was absolutely humongous. The French line was owned by the French government. The harbors in France were owned and are owned by the French government. It became a national event for the building of the greatest ocean liner in the world, and an ocean liner that would be the symbol of France afloat. Money was no object. In fact, she was laughingly called France's floating debt. She cost in excess of $60 million in the early 1930s. But what can one say about Normandie? Everything from top to bottom was to be French. The finest of French materials, designers, architects, interior decorators, furnishings and cups and saucers, mirrors, paintings, lighting, engineering, everything was to be French. She was France afloat, but Normandie was not designed by a Frenchman. Normandie was designed by a Russian. His name was Vladimir Yurkovich, a brilliant maritime architect. He had been commissioned to build a new navy for the Tsar of Russia. But in 1917, all hell broke loud. Russia had a revolution. The Tsar and his family were deposed and murdered. Anybody who could got out of Russia. And Vladimir Yurkovich ran for his life and ended up in Shanghai. Gradually, he moved his way across Europe and he ended up in Paris. And he took a menial job at the Peugeot car factory. And it was there he heard, or he read, or somebody told him, nobody knows how it all happened, but he heard that the French were thinking of building the most perfect ocean liner and the biggest ocean liner in the world. So he went to them with his CV. Of course they knew who he was. So for their everlasting good grace, the French line gave the job of designing their ship to a Russian. He didn't design the interiors, he designed the hull. He estimated the type of engine she would use. He arranged the interior spaces so that the architects would have the most incredible sized rooms to work with. And so they built this wonderful ship. She was to be 1,020 feet in length and 119 feet wide. She was to be fast. She was to win the Blue Ribbon of the Atlantic, and she would compete with the British, who were building a superliner in Scotland. Number 534 was the British ship's shipyard number. There'd no name for her at that point. She would carry 850 first-class passengers, 660 cabin class passengers, and only 460 third class passengers. She would have a crew of 1,340. Total number of a little over 3,300. She lasted only for 1,550 days and completed only 69 voyages. They gave her the name Normandie. What is this? Symbolism is very important. You can't touch it. You can't put a price on it. It's rather priceless. But symbolism literally almost makes the world turn around. And here we have a poster, which is symbolic in many, many different ways. It was a poster that was brought out before this great ship was actually built and put into service. It was an advertisement. What do we have? The Compagnie Générale Transatlantique, the French line. Underneath, the longest ship, packable steamship in the world. Normandie, in fact, was not a steamship. She was a motor ship. She worked with huge electric engines. But we have the silhouette in white of Manhattan, the first skyscraper city in the world. Today, every city is like Manhattan. But in the 20s and early 30s, it was the only one that looked like this. It was typical. Everybody would know this is New York, this is Manhattan. And on the left, the largest statue in the world, the Statue of Liberty, created, manufactured, and given to the French nation, to the American nation, by the French nation. Statue of Liberty, indicating liberty, equality, and light to the world. The Statue of Liberty is actually a lighthouse. And towering over it all, the great shape of the biggest, the best, the most luxurious ship ever to be created on this planet, Normandie. It looks like a piece of sculpture. If you had this miniaturized in steel sitting on a boardroom desk, it would look like a wonderful piece of art, modern sculpture. But this is the bows of Normandie at her launching. At the point of launching, Normandie became the largest moving structure ever created on this planet. She was launched at Saint-Nazaire. Magnificent. What did she look like? A huge yacht, traditional in the outside, up to a point. Her bow was like a swan's neck. She had three great funnels. Only two of them were necessary, and only two of them worked. Each funnel was slightly lower than the one before, and the third one was just there for symmetry. She looked as if her decks were waterfalls. So exquisitely designed were they that they went from one to the other seamlessly. These are illustrations. Normandie at sea. I'm having a little difficulty finding my thingamajig here. Right. What did Jurkiewicz do that was quite outstanding? He wanted enormous rooms. He wanted high rooms. He wanted rooms as much as possible to be unimpeded by spaces being intruded upon inside. Usually, on an ocean liner, the engines, the boilers, are in the bottom. The smoke from the engines have to come up somewhere and leave the funnels at the top. So always they went through huge areas within deck by deck by deck up to the funnels. They intruded. Rooms were designed around these huge square areas. But Jurkiewicz decided to do something different. He decided that he would split the uptakes from the engine room up through the sides of the superstructure and they then could join at the base of the funnels. That would leave the entire interior of the ship open for 500-600 feet, some of them, so he could produce these exquisite rooms. So that was the innovation of Normandie and her interiors. Very new, again, very modern. Who designed the interiors of Normandie? Well, let me see. Cassandra did the poster, ultra modern. Roulmond designed furniture. Aubusson created the tapestries and the embroideries. Jean Dupin, Mark Simon, Jean Dunand, all the top names in the world, and the top names in the world were French in interior design. Christoffel designed tableware. Lalique designed and created the glass that would be used on Normandie. The uniforms were designed by Jean Patou. Desjardins and Baudry were also employed, as were Jules Leland. Dome created wonderful glassware. Coco Chanel, Worth and Mainbosher all designed clothing and all had shops, as well as Tiffany and Cartier aboard the ship. Normandie was so luxurious, so expensive, that those who sailed on her and were very well versed with the very best were slightly overwhelmed. Normandie was wonderful, magnificent, fantastic. I cannot think of enough words for it, but Normandie was not cozy. She was anything but cozy. I have here, and you can have a look at, this is a staircase going down to a main lounge. The walls were not wood. All European ships usually were lined with rare woods. Normandie was glass, aluminium, lacquer work, painting, height. Here is a film showing Normandie on her maiden voyage. June 1935. Can we have a bit more sound, please? So smooth was her hull, she hardly made any bow waves. Sleek, beautiful, majestic. The first ship ever to have her name in lights between the funnels. A fashion parade in mid-Atlantic.
This program comes to you from the SS Normandie in mid-ocean. The program of May Salavain aboard the SS Normandie includes a fashion show extraordinary. A bevy of beautiful girls are passing in review, displaying the latest styles, not only in furs, but in complete apparel for milady, from shoes to chapeau.
Thank you.
huge deck spaces. There's her name. Fancy dress ball. Mid-Atlantic, smoke coming out of the first two funnels, not out of the third. End of the voyage, magic. Interiors. Well, I'll tell you a little bit about the interiors of the ship. The rooms were vast. The furniture was exquisite. Here, huge staircase going down into a room that could be subdivided by sliding doors, or you could have one vast area 600 feet from the forward section virtually to the end or the promenade deck. 400 armchairs, all hand embroidered at the Aubusson embroidery factory. Normandie had no stabilizers. Normandie rolled like a pig. All great liners rolled alarmingly. The furniture had to be extremely heavy. The squabs had to be very low. The legs had to be very short so that they would not be thrown all over the place. Lights? Well, lights were shot out of huge urns and also glass. Here is a huge mural, which is glass. It's mirrored, lacquered, carved from the back by Jean Dunand. This is now in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. Hallways, 30 feet in height, the hallways. Leather furniture, they never had leather furniture in the 1930s until this developed. A staircase going up to the chapel. A walkway lined with sentinels of light in red lacquer with gilded tops throwing the light onto the ceiling. A Norman knight, a huge embroidery where they got the name Normandie from, leading into a chapel. The chaplain was in fact a bishop. The chapel on Normandie was considered a mini cathedral. They called Normandie a city at sea. Normandie was also the first ship ever to have a Jewish synagogue. The first theater ever on an ocean liner. We have one here which is magnificent. We're almost 100 years later. This was as wonderful as you would get in any modern complex in New York or in Paris. The walls and the ceilings were all done in gold leaf. Everything that looked gold on Normandie was in fact 18 karat gold plate or 18 karat gold leaf. Here you would put on movies, you would put on an opera, you could have a ballet, you could have a play. You could go to see a wonderful Hollywood musical that were beginning to use interiors of the great ships for their interiors of Hollywood musical films, and you could sit in that beautiful theater in a real theater seat, as we do here, and you could nudge your neighbor and say, "Is that Ginger Rogers down there?" Very possibly it was. everybody who was anybody eventually sailed on Normandy. Beauty parlors, elevators, 32 elevators, all protected by wrought iron and the little shells done in gold. Look at the furniture. This looks familiar. Brand new then, 1935. Her observation lounge was in fact a garden lounge with gardens, palm trees, and two huge bird cages filled with tropical birds. The doors to the main restaurant, the doors themselves were almost 20 feet in height. They were bronze, with huge bronze rondelles aboard. These doors are now in a church in Brooklyn, New York. The restaurant itself, well, nothing like it has ever been seen before or since. The restaurant on Normandy did not go from one side of the ship to the other. It was a complete interior room. It was over 350 feet long. It was longer than the Hall of Mirrors at Versailles, but it was under 80 feet in width. You entered down a staircase, as you did on all French liners, and this was the scene that greeted your eyes. Fantastic. From floor to ceiling, the entire restaurant's walls were all constructed of carved and hand-beaten Lalique glass, all illuminated from the back. On each corner of this restaurant, there would be a private restaurant for 4 or 6 or 8 or even 12 people, separate. Each one of those restaurants had their own chef. The chef on Normandy was the chef of chefs of France. The food, of course, was superb. You had menus for dinner with some 40 different items on it. The swimming pool. Well, the swimming pool was 82 feet long and 22 feet wide, decorated by Jean Dunand, and all the tiles were of Sèvres porcelain. Even the men didn't go topless in the 1930s. The suites, the cabins deluxe, the apartments, no two were identical. This is an illustration from a brochure of the lounge of one of the great suites. The walls were covered in pigskin. The wood was ebony. The handles were ivory. And in five of the main suites, there was a baby grand piano. And here we have a young Marlene Dietrich nonchalantly leaning against her black lacquer piano in a suite, the Rouen suite, filled with flowers. Everybody who was anybody went on the maiden voyage of Normandy. She was definitely a who's who. And if you were of a certain age and you didn't particularly like all that modernity and you came from your chateau in southern France somewhere, you could have up to 6 traditional suites. This is the Marie Antoinette suite. The grill room aft, black marble, black leather, twisted metal furniture, first time ever to be seen. Promenade decks, enclosed. You came aboard and you did it in all the transatlantic liners of the great age. You booked a deck chair with cushions and rugs. The deck chair would cost you 10 shillings or the equivalent. Your cushions and rugs would be another 10 shillings for about £1. You had a deck chair with your name on it, and nobody sat on that chair during the voyage. And in the morning, you would be served, if you wish, to have hot soup and crackers. In the afternoon, a full afternoon tea would be served at your chair, if you wished. Tennis courts, squash rackets, look at that funnel. That's what I call a funnel. fantastic. Rolling like a pig. Tremendous seasickness, of course. But the French line came up, as the French line would, with elegance, a cure against seasickness. Try it. Wonderful. It works. Equal parts of Guinness and champagne. Have enough of that and you don't care what the ship does. And here, towards the end of its particular era, Normandy in New York. 69 voyages completed, 1,550 days. Normandy was in New York when France was defeated by Germany. The crew of Normandy were sent home to fight for France. A skeleton crew were there, and they discovered that the fire precaution on Normandy didn't match that of New York Harbor, for some strange reason. But after Japan attacked America, America declared war on Germany and declared war on Japan. And America took over Normandy to become a troop ship. Her name was changed from Normandy to Lafayette, and they started to convert the ship to be a troop ship. They took out all the art, they took out all the wonderful furniture, they put it into storage, and they took out all the wines, and you can still buy a bottle of Normandy champagne at the Waldorf Astoria in New York. And one horrendous day, a worker was using an acetylene torch, and they had been bringing on some 15,000 Kapok-filled life jackets on the ship because she would carry over 15,000 troops during the war. And it started a fire. And as they say, a fire spreads like wildfire. And it did. It swept through Normandy and they couldn't do anything really about it. They poured water onto it. Fireboats came down the Hudson. Fire brigades came from every part of New York. Everybody in New York knew Normandy was on fire. The smoke was going all over Manhattan. This is one of the last photographs taken of the Grand Staircase. And here, Normandy is getting heavier and heavier as they're pouring water onto her. It can't get away. Gradually, then faster, Normandy literally turned over and died in the icy waters of the Hudson. The French were appalled. We've lost France, but now we have lost the symbol of France. How could the Americans have done this to us? And there it is, this horrible sight of the world's most beautiful ship lying like a beached whale. Eventually, she was raised at the end of the war, towed away ignominiously and broken up. Wasn't the end of the French line. At the end of the Second World War, two great German liners, the two greatest French German liners that had been built before the war, the Bremen and the Europa, the Bremen was completely destroyed. Europa had been bombed. Europa had sunk, but they raised the Europa. They patched her up and America used her for a while as a troop ship. And then Europa was given to France as reparations for the war. And they rebuilt it and they gave her a marvelous name. They called her the Liberté and they used a lot of what had been on Normandy to create this new flagship for France. She was no Normandy, but she was a magnificent ocean liner of 50,000 tons, the Liberté. And she sailed in concert with the Ile de France. Eventually, in the 1960s, Charles de Gaulle decided he wanted a symbol of France on the Atlantic. Stupid idea. Everybody was getting out of ships in the 60s. They were flying. They were buying Boeing aircraft. We had the great QE2, which was also a great gamble at that time, became one of the world's greatest ocean liners and cruise ships. And the French built a new ship called the France. 1,035 feet long, the longest ocean liner ever built, exquisite on the outside, wonderful on the inside, but not like her mother. The daughters of beautiful women are seldom as beautiful as their mothers. It was laid up almost 2.5 years. The France was laid up, and it was discovered by a Norwegian entrepreneur. He bought it, and he decided he wanted to have the world's largest cruise ship. So he rebuilt the France, renamed her, and she became known as the Norway. And she sailed for many years as the largest cruise ship and the beginning of a trend. She was 70,000 tons, and today cruise ships are 200,000 tons. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the Fabulous French. We're now going to islands and islands and islands, and I have a holiday also. And when we leave the islands on our next sea day, I will talk to you about the great British ships of state, the ship that literally fought a battle with Normandy, our great Queen Mary. Ladies and gentlemen, have a wonderful day, and thank you for coming. Bye-bye. Thank you.